I'm the only person, right, who actually sits there and attacks the Prime Minister.
Two of the leading agencies, non-governmental agencies in the world that rate or assess democratic health in the world, the Freedom House and the Varieties of Democracy Institute in Sweden, which has risen to prominence of late, both have downgraded Indian democracy. Freedom House calls India now partly free, not unfree, partly free. And that is after 30 odd years that India has been downgraded. The VDEM Institute in Sweden uses a stronger term. India has the largest democracy, and I'm citing now, the largest democracy in the world has become an electoral autocracy. Electoral autocracy is the term it has used. Not yet a full autocracy, but electoral autocracy. Now, I have two questions. One, do you agree with this assessment? The second question is, are you concerned that the integrity of elections might also be attacked before long?
These institutions, of course, have their view. They are foreign institutions. And frankly, we don't need a stamp from them. But directionally, what they're saying is correct. I would add one thing. I would say they're much behind the curve. I think the situation is actually much worse than they imagine.
So if anything, you're saying Freedom House and VDEM Institute are behind the curve. The situation is much worse.
Yeah, and I'm saying the sequence that you first attack this, then you attack the vote. I'm saying you don't need to attack the vote. With modern technology, if you control WhatsApp and you control Facebook, you don't need to attack the vote. Why would you do something like that? Leave it alone. If you look at the strategy employed by the Muslim Brotherhood, right, and the strategy employed by the RSS, it's implicit in what they're doing. It's in there, right? They're basically saying capture power through the electoral process, capture the institutions, and then the electoral process is irrelevant.
Are you saying that a better imagination about a rural India will be a negotiated imagination?
I'm saying that the only imagination is a negotiated imagination. I'm saying there is no other imagination, right? If you stop the negotiation, if you destroy the architecture of negotiation, you don't have a country. When I go to Tamil Nadu, when I'm going and giving a speech in Tamil Nadu, it's part of the negotiation. I'm going there and they're saying, okay, you know, what is the contract that Tamil Nadu is going to have with the rest of India? Right? It's embedded in the system. If you attack that, you will not realize, but the blowback that will come will be unstoppable.
This cadre structure of the organization as it enters the hinterland is what was destroyed or at least weakened. And so how are you thinking of the civil society, the grassroots organizational structure of the Congress? What role does that play in the kind of spread of this alternate narrative?
Congress Party has never had a cadre, and it doesn't believe in a cadre. And the day the Congress Party has a cadre, it becomes the BJP. A cadre is a person who puts out a particular message. He's a pracharak. He puts out a particular ideology. That's not what a Congress worker does. A Congress worker manages a negotiation. Two fundamentally different things. This idea that there was a Congress party that had these, you know, workers in brown shorts that used to do all this is just wrong. It has never existed. What the Congress party had were people coming out of these movements that were negotiating settlements. And our big negotiator was Mahatma Gandhi. And then there was Nehru and others, right? But the Congress has never had a structure that goes out and puts across its message. That's just not what we do. That's what the RSS does. That's what the BSP does. We don't need a cadre. We don't want a cadre. What we want is people who manage, who operate as the bridge between communities.